Thank you so much. Hello and welcome to our roundtable discussion on COVID-19's impact on women. I'm Jennifer Nuzzo, Senior Fellow at the Council on Foreign Relations, and I'm very pleased to be presiding over today's discussion. The year 2020 marked the 25th anniversary of the Beijing Platform for Action to advance equity and opportunity for women and girls. But the passing of this milestone was not marked by celebration. Rather, in 2020, UN Women issued a progress report warning that global progress towards gender equality is faltering and that hard-won advances are being reversed. And a key factor cited in driving this worrisome backsliding is COVID-19. In addition to demonstrating extraordinary harms across the globe, the pandemic has deepened pre-existing social, economic, and health inequalities of all kinds. And today, we're going to be examining one of these disparities, the pandemic's differential impacts on gender. The short list of impacts on women and girls is really quite staggering. Compounded economic impacts are felt by women who are already earning less. Interruption or cessation of women's preventative and therapeutic health programs, including sexual and reproductive health services, reported increase in gender-based violence, and setbacks in efforts to get more girls into school threatened by global interruptions in education. We're going to talk about these impacts as well as what we can do to recover from them and to regain momentum on closing the gender equality gap. And today, fortunately, we're joined by two top experts on these issues, Dr. Julia Smith and Dr. Clare Wenham. They're noted scholars in the area of global health governance and co-leaders of the groundbreaking project on gender and COVID-19, which began, I think, as a working group that helped shine a light, really one of the earliest lights, on the potential disparities that COVID-19 could have on women and girls. And since those early days of the pandemic, when they brought our attention to these issues, their working group has now grown considerably and I think is now a multi-country effort that is tracking, characterizing, and interpreting COVID-19's impact on women and girls. But I will let Julia and Clare tell us more about their work and why we should be concerned about the gendered impacts of COVID and what can be done to address the harms that the pandemic has caused. So Clare and Julia have each agreed to give some framing remarks, and then we'll jump into discussion. So with that, Julia, would you like to go first in talking to us about these issues?
Sure. Thank you so much for having me and to everyone for being there, being here. I thought when I was thinking about how to begin this conversation today, I reflected back on a piece I wrote for the Council of Foreign Relations publication called Think Global Health, back in February 2020. And in that piece, I asked a series of 7 questions about gender and COVID. And if you think back to February 2020, there was very little that we knew then. And we hadn't been through all we've been through. So I thought a good way to start this conversation would be to reflect back on those questions and think about if we have answers to them, what new questions have emerged in the interim. So the first question I asked was, if data was being disaggregated by sex, and if so, what was it showing? And what were the causes of any differences? So the answer to that question is some data is. So Global Health 50/50 is monitoring this, and they show about 138 countries are disaggregating COVID cases by sex. Much fewer countries are disaggregating testing, hospitalizations, deaths, and vaccinations by sex. And so this is really important because it's really hard to, of course, to understand cases without understanding who's getting tested. And outcomes obviously are also crucially important. I think now a year and almost a half into the pandemic, the other question that's emerged that's really important is if data is being disaggregated, not only by sex, but by other intersecting factors. So race and ethnicity, for example. And we're seeing in specific cases where we do have this data. So for example, in a number of US states, African-American and people of Hispanic descent are showing much higher case loads and deaths and hospitalizations. We're also seeing trends amongst healthcare workers where more women than men are becoming infected with COVID. And again, in the UK, we can see that more healthcare workers from minority ethnic groups are becoming infected. So I think this raises a number of really important questions about why this is and how that is addressed. The second question I asked was, who's caring for the ill, both formally and informally? And, you know, not surprising, the prediction was that it would be mostly women, and it is mostly women. We know 80% of the health workforce is women. I have been doing very intensive research here in Canada on the experiences of women health and care workers. And that research is showing extremely high levels of trauma and stress amongst healthcare workers, amongst the women on the front lines. There's particularly a high level of moral distress. So that's the distress of not being able to provide the care required and feeling the guilt for that. And some of this relates to the emergency response and people not having the right information or equipment. But a lot of it here in the Canadian context also relates to staffing shortages that preempted COVID, and the fact that many people working, for example, in long-term care were working in conditions where there wasn't enough staff prior to COVID. And that's been exacerbated by COVID. And this is causing high levels of stress and severe impacts on those providing care. I think a question I would ask now, looking back on the pandemic, is not only who's caring for the ill, but who's caring for the kids. And we've all seen the data around women leaving the work, being forced out of the workforce. And some of that relates to the sectors that are most impacted by COVID. So the service and hospitality sector. But it also relates to women having to leave work to take care of children. And we know around the world, women still do 2 to 3 times the amount of unpaid care work than men. And that is only increased with COVID. Again, my research here in Canada is showing that not only has childcare forced women out of the workforce, it's preventing them from returning. So in my interviews, I've found that women are unable to return to work because they don't have childcare. They need to apply for jobs, search for jobs, go through interview processes. They're also discouraged from returning to work because they're concerned about further interruptions. The next question I asked, are those mostly women who are caring for the ill? And in this case, we could also say, and the kids being fairly compensated? And the short answer, again, it's context specific, but the short answer is no. So even here in Canada, where we have a fairly robust health system and decent labor standards, many people, for example, working in long-term care facilities were making just above minimum wage before the pandemic. Many had to work multiple part-time jobs. Here, there's been a pandemic pay increase, so many people, basically everyone doing frontline health and care work, is now making about $20 an hour, which is a great increase for many of these women. However, to put it in perspective, here in Vancouver, the living wage is $19 an hour, so they're making just above that. And again, I think we need to now ask questions about those providing childcare and if they're also being fairly compensated, considering how essential childcare has proven to be to our society and economy and how essential it'll be going forward. The next question was about who is making decisions about the outbreak response. Again, the very easy prediction that was that it'd be mostly men from the dominant socioeconomic groups, and that it is exactly what we're seeing. 75% of those in leadership roles are men and Western educated men. One interesting finding that I can draw on again from my own more localized research is around decision-making in health systems. So the healthcare workers I spoke to talked about how not only was decision-making remaining male-dominated, but they felt it was becoming less inclusive and consultative. And partly this was because of the emergency, the response, the need to make decisions quickly. But they also felt that sometimes emergency response was used as an excuse not to consult with a broader constituency group and with healthcare workers. Women also reported higher rates of sexism and racism within the health system, perpetuated by leadership within the context of COVID. And again, they felt that in some cases, this is a reaction to the stress that leaders were going through, but it also reflected underlying prejudices that had existed pre-COVID. The next question was about if there are people that were going to be stigmatized specifically because of COVID. Here, I think in lots of North America, we've seen very high rates of anti-Asian stigma and racism. And this is, again, particularly been directed towards women working on the front lines, and in many cases goes to the point of being physical violence. So now we need to ask more difficult questions about how to counter that. Some of the final questions were around if there are specific groups that are vulnerable that might avoid health systems because of distrust of the health systems or of the government. Our research within the project on foreign domestic workers in a couple different contexts has shown that many of these women who have come to countries to work as nannies or in care capacities are fearful of going to the health systems. They're fearful of how it'll impact their migration status and if they'll get quality care. I spoke to one woman here who's working as a nanny, caught COVID at work, became so ill that she was to the point of putting her affairs in order because she thought she wouldn't survive, but never went to see a doctor because she was scared it would affect her permanent residency status. I think we now also really need to ask questions about those people who distrust the health system and government and how that's affecting vaccine hesitancy and our vaccine rollout, because we're seeing in many contexts that it is groups, ethnic minorities here in Canada, Indigenous people, and African Canadians who are most distrustful of the health systems and therefore less likely to get vaccinated. The final question was around sexual and reproductive health needs and if they were still being met in the pandemic. And again, this is going to be varied across, you know, contexts. We've seen some, I think, really interesting innovations around improving access to, for example, contraception, but also some regressive policies. So those were the, you know, very quickly, the seven questions I asked a year and a half ago that I kind of updated responses to. And I would just add that after I wrote this article back in early February 2020, Clare reached out to me and said, hey, this is interesting. Maybe we should do a research project around this. So it's been a very exciting journey since, and I'll stop there.
Great, thank you so much. So Clare, do you wanna pick up on the story?
Sure, absolutely. So I'm gonna talk a bit more about one of the points that Julia touched on, which is about the economic impact and how that's fallen along gender lines across our research project. As you mentioned, we have this research project which is now in 12 countries across the world. And I think what's so interesting about it is that we know gender is really context specific, but actually it's the same story again and again and again in all these countries, whether they're high income, middle income, low income, it's the same story. I mean, the flavors are slightly different, but these trends really are global. So here in the UK, at the beginning of 2020, 71% of women were employed. And within 3 months, that had dropped by 5 percentage points. And this is a trend which we're seeing across the world, right? So in the US, we know that women are 4 times more likely to have lost their jobs compared to men. In Italy and across Europe, it's now 5 to 6 times more likely that women have lost their jobs compared to men. And in lower middle income countries, it's basically really hard to put a figure on it because women are disproportionately employed in the informal economy. And so they don't have, you know, we don't have any data to know whether women have actually lost their jobs because that statistics aren't recorded. But we know that the UN is predicting there's going to be an additional 100 million women living in extreme poverty by the end of 2021 across the world. And so we need to look at this as a completely global phenomenon. Now, why does this happen? That's the question we're trying to find out, right? Why is it that women are losing their jobs much more than men across the world? Well, we think there's kind of three key reasons for this. The first one being that, in countries which offer social support schemes, we know that women are more likely to be on them than men. So here in the UK, for example, women are much more likely to be furloughed. So that's the assistance that the government's given to cover 80% of wages for sectors which aren't currently operating as normal. And so we're seeing basically women are taking a 20% pay cut immediately. Now, many of the women we spoke to said, I can't live on 80% of my salary, right? Particularly those who are single parents, then people who are in more precarious employment or at the lower end of the socioeconomic scale, they simply can't afford to live on 80% of their wages. As Julia mentioned, the second reason is we see women being out of employment because of the sectors they work in. So women disproportionately work in sectors which have been most affected by the interventions brought in to stop the spread of coronavirus. So accommodation, hospitality, retail, these are all sectors women work in, and therefore as these are shut, women are more likely to have lost their jobs. And the third one, again, speaking to another point Julia mentioned, is that women basically have absorbed all the labor associated with implementing these global health security focused policies. We've basically seen women absorbing all the paid work in terms of healthcare workers, but also the unpaid work, caring for children, but not just caring for children, caring for a sick family member, their neighbours. You know, we're seeing it's much more likely to be women doing kind of volunteering on the street to find out if they can go to the shops for someone who's shielding or vulnerable, and looking after elderly relatives as well. And we've seen, for example, that women have taken on globally, at the global level, women have taken on an additional 6.1 hours of care, additional domestic labour a day compared to men's 4.7 hours. And so even though men are doing more to help, since during the pandemic, it's not as much as what women are doing. And we can also see in our data a breakdown between the different types of work that they're doing. So men are more likely to be doing developmental care. So they're more likely to be playing with the kids, doing the homeschooling, some of the more fun stuff around being a parent. And women are more likely to have absorbed all the non-developmental care. So that is, you know, feeding your children, cooking, bathing, have they got what they need? You know, it's all that kind of stuff that happens behind the scenes. And so, you know, we know that this is a problem. But the next question I had then is, well, why do women absorb all this additional labor compared to men? And again, we think there's three key reasons for that. The first one is, well, if women are working in sectors which are already shut, then, well, they're going to be at home, and then they can be the ones who take on all this additional care in the household. So if they're at home anyway, it makes a lot of sense. The second one is the gender pay gap, right? So if you're in a dual parent household and you're making decisions about who's going to look after the kids and who's going to remain in paid employment, it's going to be the person who earns the most. However, some other research that's happening from colleagues of mine here at LSE have shown that actually, even when you control for the gender pay gap and you include couples in your sample where the man earns less than the woman, we still see women doing more household labor and stuff during the pandemic. So that's not enough of a reason. And so the final reason is this cultural longstanding gender norms. And again, regardless of where you are in the world, these seem to be really compelling. And indeed, there's been other research recently by some psychologists who've shown that gender norms tend to go, or sort of all norms, but particularly gender norms, tend to veer towards more conservative values at times of crisis. So they've measured this during different times of conflict, during the financial crisis, and again during COVID. And we're really seeing this played out here. And so we're seeing this real global trend, and this has short and long-term effects. So in the short term, I mean, the stories we're hearing from women as part of our studies is basically they are completely at their bandwidth, right? It's affecting mental health. The mental health rates are going up inversely proportional to age. So it's younger women, particularly women who have younger children, who are, you know, suffering the worst from this. And we're hearing a lot of women feeling like they don't really have any self-worth, right? They're just here to be a parent and to, you know, be doing the kind of things they have to do to get through the day, rather than feeling like they might have lost their jobs or their careers or their future opportunities. And this has long-term effects as well. And so we know, for example, there's going to be changes to the economy as we go forward, right? Will the same sectors still exist? Will women be able to get jobs in the sectors they traditionally have? Or do we need to think about ways of retraining women in different sectors, for example? And a key part of this, again, as Julia mentioned, is making sure there's childcare available. We know here in the UK, the childcare sector is extremely precarious prior to the pandemic, and it's like, and many places have now shut down. And so if childcare isn't available, then women aren't going to be able to simply go back to work. And these long-term effects, and I think that the point about this, which is so important, is it's not new, right? What's happening during COVID to women happened during Ebola, it happened during Zika. So, you know, the Ebola outbreak, we knew that a year after the epidemic, 63% of men had returned to work compared to only 17% of women. And for Zika, we know that 5 years later, from the kind of peak of the epidemic, 90% of women who had children born with congenital Zika syndrome still haven't returned to work. And so we see these really long-term trends. And I think this is the point that almost upsets me the most when I think about this, is we knew this, right? We knew this, and we could have done something about it. And, you know, Julia and I tried. We had lots of meetings early on in the pandemic. I remember being in one with a cabinet office here in the UK and saying, like, this is what's going to happen. And they said, no, London's not Liberia. It will never happen here. And, you know, look where we are 15 months later, these trends are truly global. And so that tells me that we're not getting through to policymakers, right? And there's something happening, which means that all this data and all this evidence isn't being sold, right? It's not enough of a compelling reason to do something about it. And so I think we really need to kind of, as a kind of what do we do next and where do we go from here, is really try and figure out how can we make this argument and how can we get policymakers to understand that this is a serious problem which has real long-term effects.
Thank you. That's really, both of you, very sobering. I mean, it seems to me hard that we can, find more reasons to be worried about the impacts of COVID-19, but I think you really shined a light on some troubling long-term issues. To your point about how we make the case and how we, do better for next time, given that this was predictable, as you outlined, do you think that, and I'm sorry, I should pause and say that we're going to go into a question and answer session, and I'm going to have, I have some questions that I'll ask first, but we're going to open it up to the attendees. So please feel free to raise your hand and get in the queue to ask questions. And we'll turn it over. But just while everybody's doing that, I'm just going to kick off the question and answer session with some of my own burning questions. Presider is prerogative here. So on that point of sort of better making the case, do you feel like some of the literature and particularly some of the economic, kind of retrospective economic analyses appropriately or sufficiently look at the gender disparities, not just as its own discrete category, but, as part of the whole and calls it out? Because it seems like it's one thing to talk about the disparities as its own discrete thing, but unless you sort of show it as part of the whole impacts of these events, it seems a little bit divorced from this is what we need to do as part of our preparedness to address these issues. And I'll pose it to both of you.
The short answer is no. I think there's been a neglect of looking at the drivers of gender disparities in economic analysis in general, except for the feminist economics literature, which, for decades now has been pointing out this relationship between the care economy, so the paid and unpaid care work that's done mostly by women, and the broader, more formal economy. So that literature, has been around for decades, but I don't think has been fully integrated into mainstream economic analysis or recognized by policymakers and addressed. And picking up on Claire's example from her conversations in the UK about the policymakers saying, London isn't Liberia, I definitely heard the same thing. And I remember having a conversation with an economist in the federal government here in Canada. And he was looking at analysis from previous recessions. So this was probably about almost exactly a year ago. And he said, okay, COVID's going to cause a recession. But when we look at recessions in Canada, we see it's actually mostly men that are affected because it's our big industries that are affected. And I was trying to say, this is going to be different. This isn't like other recessions. This is a public health crisis, and that has gendered implications. And I think that is another sort of intersection that hasn't been fully explored, is that when it comes, there are gender dimensions around a public health crisis and health security that need to be considered if we're also going to look at the economic context. Claire?
Yeah, I agree completely with what Julia said. I think that there's this lack of, certainly here in the UK, everything's about the economy, right? And that's the priority, and gender comes way down the list after it. And so when you start to build thinking about gender into the economy, and you talk about the care economy, and you make the point that, that there's actually analysis that comes out all the time, basically showing if you invest in the care economy, healthcare workers, childcare, whatever, you get a better return on your investment than if you invest in construction workers, because it has a multiplier effect. We see those effects happen across society, and they're more extreme than they are if you invest in construction. But governments just don't want to listen. And, depending on how cynical I am on different days, is it strategic? Is it trying to keep women, out of their unemployed lists and in the kind of not actively looking for work lists, because that looks better for them? Or is it simply just, you know, as Julia's, you know, said before, the kind of tyranny of the urgent? We haven't got time to think about this. We're thinking just about public health and the economy, and everything else kind of falls by the wayside. But I think we have to, you know, these effects are going to be long term, unfortunately, right? It's going to take, I would argue, decades to get women back to the same level of employment, for example. And that's a massive issue, right? For gender equality, for labor force production, you know, economic development. And so I think we have to really address it.
I'm struck by how multifaceted the impacts are, you know, in health and economy, you know, just politics. I mean, really quite multi-pronged. I guess sort of kind of maybe pushing a little bit and looking towards those long-term impacts. You know, you've outlined many different areas where the disruptions and the shift are occurring, and women are, you know, either stepping out, you know, being disproportionately harmed, just a lot of gender-based shifts. I guess maybe linking it towards the longer-term impacts in terms of health and economy and developments, are there particular things that you're most worried about? I mean, there is just so much, but if you're a policymaker and you're trying to think, okay, what do we have to be most worried about going forward, you know, coming out of COVID, that we're going to see real, you know, very concerning signals right away? You know, what do you think is going to float to the top?
Well, I think we could look at what's floated to the top already, right? Because I think we should be fair to governments, right? Which is that we've seen much more recognition of gender in COVID than we've ever seen in previous health crises, mm-hmm. right? I mean, we've been beating this drum for some years and like no one cared. And it was always retrospective analysis, looking at how this impacted women in Liberia or in Brazil or whatever it was. And, you know, governments are thinking about it in real time. And I think that's a good step in the right direction, that recognition's happening. But they're thinking about gender in a very narrow way. And actually, Jill and I were having a conversation just yesterday looking at some of the global level policy analysis we're doing. Basically, that, you know, when governments and international organizations are starting to think about gender, it's kind of either about maternity and pregnancy care, or it's about gender-based violence, right? And so women are either mothers or victims. And it's this kind of dichotomy that's like, but what about everything else? And I'm not trying to minimize anything about gender-based violence or about provision of maternity care. Those are obviously really important. But I wonder if it's the kind of, it's the low-hanging fruit which governments can try and start with, rather than tackling this big issue of like how to value care in your economy, which is going to be so much more complicated and costly.
Julian,
I would only add to that, in terms of the issues that I think are going to have really long-term effects, is the toll all of this is taking on women's well-being, so their physical health and their mental health. I think Clare would agree with me in our conversations and the research we've done with women around the world. It is incredibly concerning what women have gone through, and the stress and anxiety, and we know that has very long-term effects. And I should say, not just on health, but also on, you know, career and personal development. And that is something that needs to be reckoned with if we're gonna recover.
Yeah. So on that note, with recovery, what do we need to do to recover? I mean, what are some things that governments should be doing, or IGOs doing? You know, we're 25 years after the Beijing platform, obviously headed in a very worrisome direction. How do we regain momentum? Do we need new initiatives, new policies? What would be on your wish list now, knowing what you know about what kind of impacts have been? How do we fix them? Go ahead,
Clare.
I mean, don't think we need new policies. I think we just need to get gender in the policies we have, mm-hmm. and get that working first, right? I mean, if you look at all the key policies we have at national levels, at global levels, you know, the IHR, the JEE, the Biological Weapons Convention, I mean, none of these have gender in them, right? Or if they do, it's very kind of notional tacked on. We need like meaningful gender mainstreaming of these policies, and holding governments to account that way, right? Like, why not? Why shouldn't governments have to report the gendered effects you know, under their JEE requirements, like they have to report their EPI data, for example. And then that might hopefully have a trickle-down effect of governments doing it. And I think, you know, we need to make sure that they are taking gender analysis seriously. I mean, we have good examples of places like Canada, which actively try and take this kind of gender-based analysis to their policy making. And then you have other countries which don't do anything at all. And, you know, I'm not suggesting that Canada is doing amazingly. Our data is showing it's a mixed picture. But, you know, we know what works, and we can look to other areas of crisis governance, right? Humanitarian governance, climate change governance. They all have a requirement to have gender advisors involved, right? They all have a requirement to do impact assessments of interventions. Why don't we expect the same for health emergencies?
That's interesting. Julie, anything to add on that?
I guess I agree with everything Clare said. The only thing I would add, and Clare mentioned this in her opening remarks about the UK, in terms of the need also for a normative shift and a cultural shift. And I don't know, like, that is much harder to operationalize. It's harder to integrate into policies. You can do the formal, but we also need something happening in a less formal way. Because when we look at, okay, why has there been all this attention to gender, but we're not seeing different outcomes? I think it part of it goes back to the need to have like a really, you know, cultural shift at the local and national level, but also at the global level, to take these issues seriously, to act on them, and to shift how workloads are determined and what is prioritized.
Great. Well, I'm going to allow the audience to start asking questions. I have a lot more. So depending on how many questions we have, I'm going to probably come back to you with some. But I'm going to turn it over to our event staff to talk about the instructions for the Q&A portion. Thank you so much. And I'm going to go to Suzanne Petroni. You're on my list here. You want to come off mute and ask your question?
Yes, hi. I don't think I'm on the participant list, but my name is Suzanne Petroni. I'm a consultant. The company is called Gender Equality Solutions. Thank you so much for this discussion. Julia mentioned that we've seen innovations around, for example, contraception. I think we can hope for the possibility that this crisis has the potential to leapfrog movement on sexual and reproductive health, for example, around telemedicine for medication abortion or self-injecting contraception. And I know there's no magic elixir for the care discussion that we're having, but first, if you could tell us the 12 countries that you're looking at, and second, recognizing this point about the need for normative and cultural shift, do you see any examples of policies in those countries or discussions of policies in these countries that could potentially act as kind of that similar leapfrog that self-injecting contraception, for example, could regarding care or the other issues that you're talking about? Thanks.
Great, thank you. Julia or Clare, or both, want to chime in on that?
So the countries we are looking at are Canada, the UK, I should say case studies, Canada, the UK, China, Hong Kong, oh my goodness, I am forgetting, Brazil, Nigeria, Kenya, DRC, and we're just beginning research in Papua New Guinea and the Philippines, and we had planned to conduct research in Myanmar, which now, you know, of course, is on hold. So those are the countries. From what I'm understanding from your questions in terms of examples to leapfrog, I understand you're asking for, like, you know, those positive examples that we can learn from. And I think in terms of reproductive health, the UK led a lot of those, and Clare can talk more about that in terms of getting contraception by post. I think the shift to virtual health care also, like here in Canada, has really increased access for a lot of people, but also decreased access. So it's a very complicated picture in that case. And I'm trying to think of really good examples of kind of shifts in the care economy. And I'm honestly drawing a blank. Clare, can you think of any kind of examples?
I can think of a bit. So we don't have any examples from our country. So we don't think actually our countries are doing a very good job. in terms of it, apart from, as Julia says, the reproductive health stuff, telemedicine for abortion and contraception by post, which is happening in the UK. And I was delighted to see in the US they've now allowed telemedicine for abortion this week. So that's amazing. But we do have other countries that we're sort of following broadly, places like Germany, who are doing things about the care economy. So Germany has made a national requirement for every parent to get an additional 20 days paid leave in 2020 and 2021, and 40 days paid leave if you're a single parent. They've also introduced a kinder bonus, so giving a payment of 300 euros a child a year, to try and accommodate some of the additional burden and costs that parents are bearing. And I'm not suggesting this is a solution, but I think we're seeing kind of positive steps going forward of countries trying to recognize this in some ways. I think what we need to look out for is what happens next, and that's the bit that we don't necessarily have the data on, right? Like, are governments looking to bail out particular industries, and is any government looking to bail out the childcare sector? Because I think that's the big kind of linchpin, right? Like, when the childcare sector collapses, are we going to have the payment there for this, and are we going to see training schemes for women or any kind of mechanism to ensure women get back into employment where possible?
Thank you for that. I'm going to turn next to Sophia Sokolowski. Hope I pronounced your name correctly, Sophia.
That was beautiful. Thank you. Sophia Sokolowski, and I am a Master of Science in Foreign Service candidate at Georgetown University. And thank you to the three of you for being here today and talking about this important topic. My question specifically is about capitalizing on financial influence to drive gender-specific policies in order to yield more equitable results. And so I wanted to ask if you've thought about gender bonds and how they can be deployed in countries that access and borrow money from the global market in order to provide incentives to drive a more gender-inclusive economy and keep women in the workforce. I know they're a fairly new instrument, so I'm doing my own research on them now.
Yeah, do you have any thoughts on that, Claire or Julia?
I don't have any thoughts on it yet. I think it's, again, like Sophia said, it's early days with this. And I don't, as far as I'm aware, it hasn't actually been implemented anywhere. Maybe you can correct me. I haven't heard of it other than as a kind of ideational idea. I think it's too early to say. I mean, there's lots built up in that, right? And lots of tensions with it. You shouldn't be incentives come at costs. And, do you want to change norms or do you want people to be doing it, based on performance? And I think we just need to unpack that a bit more.
Sophia, was there any examples that you wanted to cite in particular, or?
I have not seen them used in regards to COVID, but I was just reading, there was a study the other day where USAID was working with one of the, I think it was a cabinet member from in Australia, and I'm probably butchering this just a bit, but they were employing gender bonds back in 2019, and it was still in the early stages. They have evaluation and monitoring techniques that are on the ground, but that data have not yet been published. But I think that it could potentially be an interesting tool. And of course, there are definitely risks associated with it, in the same way that we thought microloans were a good solution. There were ramifications as well. But yeah, I'm trying to think about those a bit more and how finance can drive more gender inclusive societies.
Great, thank you for bringing that to us. I'm going to turn to Anju Malhotra. Again, apologies if I mispronounced your name.
Oh, no, you did very well, thank you. Hi, I'm Anju Malhotra. I'm Principal Fellow at the UN University International Institute of Global Health. And I really enjoyed listening to your talk. I had two questions. One question and one comment. So my one question is that have you considered an analysis of when disruptive change is actually a catalyst for positive gender norm change versus negative gender or reinforcement of gender norms. So we know that there have been disruptive changes like wars that are actually very quickly putting women in leadership and economic positions of influence. And so it would be interesting to hear that. And my comment is that I think that, you know, trying to mainstream gender and integrate it into economic or health or any other policies is a horse that just has been beaten to death, and we perhaps need to just abandon it and stop complaining about politicians not listening to and looking at evidence that's done separately from their main concerns. And the question is, are there a few critical areas that we could now rally around that would be the solutions that would create deep lasting change? And innovation around technology and women addressing the gender technology gap might be one area. But when I think of sort of the economic and health impact, I think a global movement to really have adequate pay for women health workers and professional credentials for women health workers, this is the time for that global policy advocacy and initiative. It's a very clear ask that we should have been making all along. It's become an entrenched care work that women are not paid well for, are exploited in so many ways. But this is the time to go with that kind of an ask that's very concrete, very focused, very global.
Great, Julia, I saw you come off mute.
Yeah, thanks. There's so many things in your questions and comments there that I think you raise really good points. And the one about disruptive change, I think, is interesting. And I remember reflecting on this at the beginning of the pandemic. And, you know, that, as you mentioned, the evidence we have from conflicts where women often get into positions of leadership and empowerment during a conflict. We also have evidence that after conflicts, there's also a regression, right? So a return to pre-conflict gender norms or even greater levels of disparities. And I think that evidence should be cautionary in the context of COVID. I don't know if we've seen, I don't know how you would measure this, and I haven't seen the full, the data about if women are taking on more empowered positions in the context of COVID, like if COVID is inspiring greater leadership by women. I think we're seeing a lot of attention to gender and a lot of attention to the role of women and celebration of women as healthcare workers and so on. But also we're seeing so many women exhausted and depleted by all of those responsibilities that there's less opportunity. So I think there's some complicated tensions there. And one of our colleagues, Sylvie Harmon, has written a good article kind of about some of these issues in terms of the positioning of women and gender in the context of COVID, which is, I think, is really interesting to look at. And then you mentioned the technology gap, and this is something I've started to look at in the context of Canada in terms of accessing services and working from home. And what we're finding is that the digital gap isn't just about technology. It's about childcare again, right? So you can't only work from home or access your health provider from home on your computer to request contraception or abortion or to seek help because of violence, whatever, if you have childcare and privacy. So there's an issue here around childcare. There's also an issue here around privacy and adequate housing that I think also relate to the technology gap that need to be addressed if we're going to close that gender gap. And yes, I love the idea of a global campaign around pay for healthcare workers. I mean, I think we really need to think about, as you said, what we can mobilize around, and the health and care sector is definitely one that at least that their contribution has been acknowledged in a symbolic way so far, and we need to move to make that a material acknowledgement.
Great. Clare, anything to add to that?
I'll just pick up. I agree with everything Julia said. I think my only comment would be That last point about healthcare workers, I mean, obviously we need, you know, fair pay for healthcare workers. You know, so many healthcare workers around the world are unpaid or underpaid, and that's unacceptable after we've spent a whole year clapping for them. I think the problem is, where's that money going to come from? And, you know, here in the UK, I can, you know, we've had effectively a pay cut for NHS staff and nurse staff because they didn't agree to increase a pay rise, and then it didn't even go as far as inflation. And so, you know, they can, there's this tension of, you know, it's the economy. And I worry that particularly at a time where we're seeing economic downturn, where's this money going to come from? Not that I'm suggesting it's acceptable to not pay women, obviously it's not, but it's easy to rally around, like it's easy to acknowledge gender, it's much more difficult to actually do something about it.
Great. Next question is from Alex Kendall.
Hi, everyone. I'm Alex Kendall, Vice President at Global Health Strategies. Thanks so much for the discussion. Actually, building off that last question, I just wonder if you could say a word more about the where the evidence is around women's leadership and the broader impact on the number of issues that you've named. And, you know, of course, we've seen the coverage this past year of countries with women leaders and what their COVID responses have looked like, but would love to hear a bit more about how strong the link is between getting more women into leadership positions in health and politics and mainstreaming gender into the policies and funding that we're talking about. Thanks.
I can jump in unless Julia wants to. So I think you're right. There's been a lot of discussion about, you know, women leaders are managing COVID better, but actually increasingly the data is showing it's not true. You know, there was some quite selective case study selection in the way those analyses were done. And I think, you know, if you only look at if you look globally, there's only been, 15 countries in the world that currently have a female leader. And so that N is far too small to make any assumptions, right? There are some women doing a really good job. There are also some women doing a less good job. There are some men doing a really good job, and there are some men doing a less good job. And actually what the data is now showing is that it's countries with women leaders are more like, or who have had women leaders in the past, are more likely to have stronger health systems. And that's meant they've been more able to be able to respond better. And so, and that has doesn't necessarily mean because they've got a women leader now. And so I think we need to more nuance this analysis. We also know that women leaders tend to govern in countries with a better social contract between people and leaders. And so therefore you might be more likely to, you know, women leaders exist in societies which elect women in the first place. And so you might be more likely to follow government guidance as a consequence. And I think partly this conversation came about is because there's some really bad men who've done really bad jobs, right? And that kind of toxic masculinity, right, that we see from Trump, Johnson, Bolsonaro, which really kind of, it plays well in the media story when you compare men versus women. But I just think there's a lot more nuance to that. The other piece of the story, which I think isn't talked about so much, is what effect women's leadership has, or women's involvement or participation in decision-making has on more gender-sensitive policies. And we've been doing some study of this in the UK, and actually we're not seeing any change. So the more women that are involved in advisory groups or committees here in the UK isn't having an effect on, you know, greater awareness of these gender issues. And I think that's probably a global truism. We can see from previous events. I mean, look to previous health crises. We had female leaders in Brazil during Zika, in Liberia during COVID, during Ebola. We didn't see gender awareness of the policy response. And so I think we need to move away from this more women in the room means better gender awareness and more recognize that we need the kind of gender expertise in the room as well as women. We obviously, we should have women in the room for gender parity's sake, but that doesn't necessarily mean we're going to have better or more gender centric or sensitive or transformative policy.
Julie, anything you'd like to add to that?
I would only add that we also need to ask about which women are in the room, right? So, you know, the gender binary of men and women is only one, you know, one instance of inequities. So we need to ask which women, you know, are there women from different priority populations present? Are there people of other genders present? Are there people from the global south, if we're talking globally? All of those questions really need to be asked. And I agree, you know, actually just having those people there isn't enough. We need expertise and we need advocates. And also to avoid the situation, I've been doing some interviews with policymakers here in Canada who talk about the frustration of being the gender person in the room. So they are like the person representing, for example, the Ministry of Women and Gender Equality. And then they say, you know, every time they come in the room, they are expected to put these issues forward, and they can almost see people sort of shutting off or like, you know, not listening just because it's all so scripted. And so that, again, this, there needs to be this gender expertise in the room, but it needs to be diffused. It needs to be in, you know, in finance, in health, in trades.
You started off, Julia, your remarks talking about the data and whether there were adequate data to track the impacts. And as an epidemiologist, that spoke to me in terms of the inadequacy of data. And I guess kind of going forward, where would you like to see there more data? And Claire, I'm going to also extend this to you, because before the session, we started talking about what sorts of research needs to be done. So just kind of looking ahead, both to understand COVID and what happened in COVID, but then also to inform better policies, practices, solutions for the next pandemic, because unfortunately this won't be our last. So we have about 6 minutes of discussion left, but maybe to turn it to you both on those two topics, on that issue.
As I said, you know, I think we need the sex disaggregated data, and then we need it disaggregated by other intersecting factors. And I believe this data needs to be made more transparent. So for example, where I live in British Columbia, Canada, our government is collecting data on race, gender, Indigenous status, and occupation, but they're not making that publicly available. And that is causing a lot of concern, a lot of distrust of the government, a distrust of government policies. I would go so far as to say, in some cases, I think it's fueling racism, and racism is one of the reasons they're using for not making it public. They're concerned that if they present race disaggregated data, it might fuel stigma and racism. But the people from the communities most affected are actually asking for that data, because they can use it then to understand what's happening in their communities and improve prevention or vaccine efforts and so on. So I would say, you know, we need that data. We need it to be transparent and available, specifically to the people most affected.
Yeah, and I'd jump in and just add, you know, we also need this data to be collected and disaggregated, not just for the health data that Julia so eloquently highlighted, but make sure we have that for all, you know, all sectors, right? For the economic data, which we don't routinely have everywhere, for the other social effects which we're seeing across the pandemic, right? The mental health issues and the, I don't know, exhaustion, I'm trying to think off the top of my head now, but you know, why can't we have as a standard all this data that's being collected be disaggregated? Because I mean, as a researcher, and Jennifer, you know, you're an epidemiologist, like this data is being collected, right? Like, you don't collect data about people and not ask if they're a man or a woman, right? Or like questions like that. So why isn't that being done? And, you know, I get that there's, you know, priority areas and, you know, we need to just get the data out quickly. But we're now, you know, over a year into this. We should have it. And we should have it as standard, right, for all issues. It shouldn't just be about COVID. But, you know, being able to see these trends allows you to then be able to identify better policies and target different populations in different ways. I mean, in the UK, and again, pointing to what Julia was saying, you know, it took us till May, June of last year to understand that it was predominantly amongst South Asian communities in the UK who were disproportionately affected from COVID. And now, had you known that from the start, then, you know, you could have created policies to be working with those communities to ensure greater protection was given to those groups, for example. And that's the same when it comes to gender analysis and of the economic data, right? Like, if we knew it was going to be particular sectors and we knew it was going to be women who were going to be losing their jobs, why weren't, you know, we could have predicted that sooner or let the data show it sooner. And then you can create policies accordingly. And so I think particularly, you know, when most governments around the world are so being led by the data, we have to make sure that that data is good data. And just to add, I would say one other thing on that, which is it's not only about disaggregating the quantitative statistical data that we're collecting, but I think it's also really important to acknowledge that there's other forms of data. And actually a lot of the gender work, gender analysis, kind of comes from sort of feminist methodologies and much kind of more quantitative storytelling, interviews, you know, other forms of collecting data, which often isn't given the same credence when it comes to policymaking, because they're saying, oh, well, you know, this is just someone, this is an anecdote, right? And I completely understand that, but that's where you get the richness of actually people's lived experience of what's happening. And I think we have to make sure that that is captured in the data we're collecting and feeding into policies as well.
Thank you for that. I can tell you, you know, my take as an epidemiologist, that we had these similar questions after the 2009 pandemic, just asking about the data and if we had the right data. And in many cases, there were data, but it wasn't, it wasn't really extracted and visualized, but in other cases, it just wasn't collected. And it seems to me that what is helpful is to articulate the questions that need to be addressed, and then to do that, you know, kind of, well, how do we answer it with either the data we have, or if we don't have the data or are likely to have it, how do we go out and get it for the next time? So hopefully we can make some progress on defining that list a bit, and, you know, so that we do learn the lessons. As you said, these were quite predictable, and I hope that the next event we're not talking about these issues again, or we're talking about them less. Thank you so much for your time today and also your leadership in this field. I know I have learned a tremendous amount from you both on these issues, and I know that you're educating a lot of the world on this, so really appreciate your early insights into this problem and your continued work and advocacy for these issues. That ends our roundtable. Very much grateful to everyone for your participation today, and we will also be making this available in a recorded form, so hope anyone who participated can share it with those who may also find it interesting. I know I did. So thank you so much.